Hello students, today we will be discussing about the chapter that is chemical reaction. So first of all, the chapter chemical reactions and its types. So basically, when two or more reactants, the two or more elements, they become combined with each other, or a particular chemical compound become dissociated, then it forms a different product. Either two or more different elements come together to fuse and form a new product, a new chemical product, that is the two or three reactants coming towards each other and forming a new chemical product, or a particular chemical compound, it becomes dissociated and forming two or more new products. So depending on this basic types, we will be discussing about two or three different types of chemical reactions. So first of all, what are the reactants and what are the products? We have to discuss about what are the reactants and what are the products. So suppose A and B, they are reacting with each other and forming a product C. So here we can all see that A and B are the reactants here, and from A and B, after the reaction, they are forming a particular product, that is C, a new product. Okay, from the product C, in case of every chemical reaction, we all know that from the product C, there cannot be a reverse reaction that can happen. Always the reactants react with each other and they will form the product, which is a new product, and we cannot get back to the previous product reactants that are A and B. Okay, so depending on the reactants, number of reactants and number of products, we can divide the types of reactions, chemical reactions, into several different types. First, there is a, we call combination reaction. So combination means we are combining one, two or three reactants to get a new product. That is, only one product we are getting using two or three different types of reactants. Like we are using A plus B plus C to get a new product, that is D. So here the number of reactants always should be two or more than two, and the product will be always in the number, that is only one product. One product will be formed. So this is called a combination reactions. Okay, like when we see that C plus O2, it becomes CO2, that is carbon dioxide gas. Here carbon and oxygen are combining with each other to form the new product, that is carbon dioxide gas. So this is the particularly we call the type of chemical reaction, that is combination reactions, where two or more reactants, two or more different types of reactants, they are combining with each other and reacting with each other to form a totally new type of product. Okay, now we will discuss the next type of chemical reaction, that is we call decomposition. We have already discussed that in case of combination reactions, two or more different kinds of reactants come together, and they, after reaction, they are formed only one type of product, one new type of product. But in this decomposition type of reactions, the whole reverse kind of scenario is happening. Like there is a compound, there is always a compound, like a compound is A, from which after dissociation of this compound A, we are getting the products B, C, D, whatever. So the compound A become dissociated to form different types of two or more products, that can be B, can be C, or can be D. These are all different kinds of products. So this type of reaction we call decomposition reaction, because here a particular compound is dissociated to form two or more defined types of products. Okay, so we can also say that decomposition reactions are absolutely the reverse of composition reactions or combination reactions. The third type of reaction we will be discussing, that is exothermic and endothermic reactions. So in case of exothermic reactions, we will see that in every reaction there will be a generation of energy. After the reaction, the total energy or total temperature of the system will be increased in case of exothermic reactions, and the reverse and vice versa will happen in case of endothermic reactions, where the total energy of the system or total temperature of the system will be decreased. As in case of endothermic reactions, the system or the reactants will absorb energy from the system in order to produce the new products. But in case of exothermic reactions, the reactants will react with each other and they will form a new product, as well as they will produce a certain amount of energy, which will eventually increase the total energy of the system or the total temperature of the system will be also increased. Okay. So exothermic reaction means, suppose two reactants A and B, they are reacting and they are producing a product C, along with they are increasing the total energy of the system. We denote the increase or we denote the total temperature increase in the total system by this signature, that is a triangular signature. Okay, so in case of exothermic reaction, the total energy of the system is being increased, or the total temperature of the system is being increased. But in case of endothermic reactions, A and B, they are reacting by absorbing a certain amount of heat to form a new product D. So in case of endothermic reaction, the total energy of the system become decreased. Okay, this sign denotes energy or heat. So this is the concept of exothermic and endothermic reactions. Now we will be discussing about the fourth category of reaction types, that is displacement reactions. What do you mean by displacement in a certain type of reaction? Displacement means we are displacing something with another thing, that is we call displacement. Like there is a compound that is Fe, or we all know that Fe means ferrous, that is iron, Fe plus CuSO4 or copper sulfate. So iron plus copper sulfate, they react with each other to form ferrous sulfate plus copper. So here we can clearly see that the more chemically reactive ferrous replaced copper from the copper sulfate compound and forms ferrous sulfate and releases free copper the molecules or free copper element. So here the chemical reactivity of ferrous is much more than the chemical reactivity of copper. That is why ferrous is replacing copper from the compound copper sulfate and forming the new product or the new compound as ferrous sulfate, along with releasing the copper as a free metal element. Okay, so this is the particular kind of or the example of displacement reactions, and you should notice that this here only one case of displacement is happening. Only ferrous is displacing copper from copper sulfate to form ferrous sulfate and copper. So only a single case scenario we are seeing in this particular reaction. So now we can assume that displacement reactions can be of two types. The first is single displacement reactions, of which we have already seen the example, that is the ferrous and copper sulfate to form ferrous sulfate and copper. And the second type we will be discussing, that will be double displacement reactions. We have already seen that in case of single displacement reaction, a particular element which is chemically more reactive than another particular element, that replaces the other. So, but in this case we will see there are two different case scenarios where the displacement reaction is happening. So we can clearly see that here sodium and barium are the two metal elements where the sodium sulfate and barium chloride reacting with each other to form sodium chloride, that is salt, and barium sulfate, that is also a kind of salt. So here the sodium is replacing barium from barium chloride to form sodium chloride, and similarly barium is replacing sodium from sodium sulfate to form barium sulfate. So we can clearly see that two different cases of displacement are happening simultaneously in a particular or in a single reaction. That is, sodium sulfate is being converted to sodium chloride and barium chloride is being converted into barium sulfate. Okay, so this is we call double displacement reaction, because two different scenarios of displacement reactions are happening simultaneously in a single particular chemical reactions. Okay, now the sixth category or type of chemical reaction we will be discussing about, oxidation and reduction reactions. So oxidation and reduction, what do you mean by oxidation and reduction reaction? See, oxidation, when we talk about oxidation, it means that one element, suppose that is A, is accepting oxygen molecules or atoms to convert into a oxide of the particular element. Suppose A plus O2 equals to form AO2. So here A, a particular molecule, combines with oxygen to form a oxide of the particular molecule, that is A. So this can be designated as oxygen. Also we can also tell that oxidation can be the releasing of hydrogen molecules or atoms from a particular compound or element. So like if A is a particular compound and it is releasing hydrogen, then it is being converted into a particular new element or compound, that is B. So here in this case we will also say that A is being oxidized. Okay, so in the both scenarios A is being oxidized. When oxygen is combining with A to form the oxide of the A, there also A is oxidized, and when the compound A is releasing hydrogen to form a new compound B, there also A is being oxidized. So there can be two different designations of oxidation reactions. Again, in the second category we have reduction reactions. In the reduction reactions, the opposite or reverse of oxidation can be considered, where a particular compound, suppose A, is releasing oxygen molecules or atoms to form a different or new product, that is B. So here A is being reduced. So reduction is happening. A is being reduced to form the new product B. And in different case scenario, when the compound A is reacting or combining with oxygen, that is, we have already discussed that, that is oxidation. But when A is releasing oxygen, it is being reduced. Or when A is reacting with hydrogen in spite of oxygen, or in place of oxygen, when A is reacting with hydrogen, then it is forming a hydride of the particular compound A or the particular element A. And then we can also say that A is being reduced. So in the both cases, A, the particular compound A, is being reduced in the both cases. When the compound A releases oxygen to form a particular compound B, also when the compound A reacts or combines with hydrogen to form a particular hydride of the compound A. So in the both cases, A is being reduced. So this is the oxidation and reduction reaction. So now we will discuss the effects of oxidation reactions in our daily lives. So as we have already discussed that in oxidation, a particular compound, suppose A, it reacts with oxygen to form the particular oxide of the same compound, that is A. Or a compound A can release hydrogen molecules or atoms to form a different compound, that is B. So these two scenarios, they both can be considered as oxidation reactions. Now when we see a particular iron metal or iron rod, when we put the iron rod in outer environment or in environment where there is a much humidity, much moisture in the environment, and in the air there is also presence of oxygen is there. So in that case, the iron or the metal containing the iron reacts with the environmental oxygen to form Fe2O3, or ferrous reacts with oxygen to form ferric oxide, and this ferric oxide is a brown or brownish layer, forms a brown or brownish layer on the metal elements or metal instruments that are present in our households. This we call rusting. So what is rusting? Rusting is nothing but the oxidation of the metal elements containing ferrous, which causes the formation of ferric oxide. Due to the oxidation of the ferrous present in the metal elements, and this forms the a brownish layer of ferric oxide on the surface of the metal elements in our household. When we expose the metal elements of our household in the outer environment in a more moisture condition or more moisture condition along with presence of oxygen in the air, so this is called rusting. And in order to prevent rusting, we see that we are coating magnesium or copper, the coating on the ferrous containing metal elements, in order to prevent the formation of brownish layer of rusting or the brownish layer of ferric oxide. So this is the concept of rusting. So we have already discussed several types of different chemical reactions. We have discussed combination reactions, we have discussed decomposition reaction, we have discussed displacement and double displacement reactions along with oxidation and reduction reactions. But what is the need of forming a particular chemical reaction? See, when we say that carbon dioxide reacts with oxygen to form carbonate, here we can see that we have written a particular statement of chemical reaction, but this particular statement is much harder to realize or much harder to denote that what the physical or chemical state of the particular reactants and what the physical or chemical state of the particular products that are producing or being produced in the particular chemical reaction. So in order to distinguish every element or every compound as reactants and as products, defined products, we have to make or consider a particular chemical reaction that is formed using different chemical formulas of different chemical elements. Like carbon dioxide is denoted here as CO2, and the specific state in which carbon dioxide remains in the natural temperature and pressure, that is in home temperature, that is gas or gaseous. And when it reacts with oxygen, the oxygen is denoted chemically as O2. It is also a gaseous or gas compound or gaseous element in room temperature. And they are forming carbonate, CO3, which is a chemical formula of carbonate. So in this manner, carbonate can be a solid or can be also obtained as gas. So we can see properly that after writing this particular chemical equation, we can denote or we can understand the statement we have already written more properly and more effectively, that carbon dioxide as a gas is reacting with oxygen as a gas to form a particular compound, that is carbonate, containing both carbon dioxide and oxygen molecules or elements in the form of either solid or gas. So this is the need or necessity of making chemical equations or forming chemical equations to denote or understand more properly and more efficiently what the chemical statements have to say. Okay. See, when we write a particular chemical equation like carbon plus oxygen that forms carbon dioxide, we can clearly see that here one carbon atom and one oxygen molecule, or two oxygen atoms, they are reacting with each other to form a single molecule of carbon dioxide, in which we can see there is one carbon molecule or one carbon atom and one oxygen molecule. So by balancing a particular chemical reaction, we can clearly denote or clearly understand what amount or what number of chemical reactants are reacting with each other to form a particular chemical product, and also we can understand how much amount or how much number of chemical atoms of chemical products are being produced in that particular chemical reaction. So this is the particular need of balancing a particular chemical reaction. Like when we see that hydrogen plus oxygen, they make H2O or water. But here we can see one hydrogen atom and one oxygen atom, they are making H2O or water that contains two hydrogen atoms and one oxygen atom. So here the chemical equation is not balanced at all. So there is a clear difference between the first chemical reaction that was already balanced, and here the chemical reaction is not balanced. So by balancing the chemical reaction, we will clearly understand what particular number of chemical reactants are reacting with each other to produce what particular number of chemical products. So now if we balance this particular reaction, that is 2H plus O, then it is forming H2O. So now we can see that there are two hydrogen atoms and 1 oxygen atom to form one molecule of water. So now we can clearly understand that what amount of hydrogen and oxygen that are reactants are reacting with each other to form what number or amount of product that they are making after the reaction. So this is the basic need or basic necessity of balancing particular chemical reactions in order to understand or denote properly or efficiently the number of reactants and the number of products that are producing in the course of chemical reaction. So now lastly we will discuss what parameters can denote that there is a particular or certain change in the chemical nature of a particular reaction, or we can say that what parameters or characteristics denote that there is a pure chemical reaction that is happening. So the parameters or characteristics of chemical reaction. So first of all, change in color. When a particular chemical reaction happens, it causes a change in color. Like when ferrous is reacting with copper sulfate, that is blue, it turns the copper sulfate solution into brownish color. Okay, so any change in the color of a particular reaction denotes that there is a situation of chemical reaction that is happening efficiently. The next is change in temperature. We have already discussed the type of chemical reactions based on the releasing or absorbing of energy, total energy from the system, of which we have already discussed that there are two types, there are exothermic and endothermic reactions. So when temperature or the total energy of the system increases, it is exothermic, and when the total energy of the system is decreased, it is endothermic. So whenever there is a change, a particular change in temperature of the system, we can denote that a chemical reaction is certainly happening. Third is release of a gas. When a particular chemical reaction happens, it causes sometimes a release of particular gases like carbon dioxide, oxygen, sulfur, etc. This release of these particular gases also denotes that some chemical reactions are absolutely happening. Like when calcium carbonate dissociates, it forms calcium molecules and calcium oxide molecules and carbon dioxide gas, which releases in the outer environment as bubbles. So by seeing the bubbles of carbon dioxide gases that is being released, we can definitely say that a particular chemical reaction is happening in the course of this particular reaction. That is, calcium carbonate is dissociated to form calcium oxide and carbon dioxide. Lastly, the denotation, for the denotation, we can say the last character of the chemical reaction is formation of precipitations. When a particular chemical reaction happens, it sometimes causes the precipitation of any metal ion or metal compounds like AgNO3, that is silver nitrate, silver sulfate, etc. These particular chemical compounds causes the formation of precipitation that is formed in the basal level of a chemical beaker. And by seeing the formation of precipitation of AgNO3, AgSO4 or something like that, we can definitely say that a chemical reaction has definitely happened in this scenario. So these are the particular characteristics or indicators of chemical reactions by seeing which we can definitely say that a particular chemical reaction is happened. So now we will discuss a few questions regarding the chapter Chemical Reactions and Type. The first question is, so in this question, we can say that magnesium ribbon, when exposed in air, it reacts with oxygen or free oxygen present in the atmosphere and it forms magnesium oxide, which creates or forms a layer of protective and chemically ineffective layer on the magnesium ribbon, which prevents the magnesium ribbon to be burned in presence of oxygen to form magnesium dioxide. So that is why the magnesium ribbon should always be cleaned. That is why the magnesium ribbon should always be cleaned before the burning with oxygen to form magnesium oxide. So in the second question, we can see that ferrous or iron is reacting with copper sulfate. The gray iron, that is ferrous in the solid form, reacts with copper sulfate, that is blue, in aqueous solution to give green colored ferrous sulfate and brown colored copper. So why the color of the solution is changing from blue to green? Because here we can see a displacement reaction is happening. A single displacement reaction is happening where the more chemically reactive ferrous is displacing less chemically reacting copper from the copper sulfate compound to form the ferrous sulfate, the compound, and releases brown colored copper metal. So this is a displacement reaction, and due to the formation of ferrous sulfate from copper sulfate, the reaction or the solution color is changing from blue to green due to this displacement reaction. So in this chemical reaction, we can see that this is a example of double displacement reaction, okay, where we can see that sodium is replacing hydrogen to form sodium sulfate, where sodium is much more chemically reactive than hydrogen. So it is, sodium is replacing or displacing the hydrogen from hydrogen sulfide or sulfuric acid to form sodium sulfate, which is a aqueous solution of salt, sodium sulfate salt. And as well as water is also forming, where hydrogen is displacing sodium from the compound sodium hydroxide to produce water. So we can clearly see in this particular chemical reaction that sodium is replacing hydrogen to form sodium sulfate, and hydrogen is replacing sodium and in another way to form water molecules. So this is an example of double displacement. A chemical reaction is being written, that is 2 lead oxide plus 1 atom of carbon is reacting to form 2 atoms of lead and 1 molecule of carbon dioxide. So out of the 4 options, which option will be the correct one? We have to recognize. So first option says lead is getting reduced, but here we can see lead oxide is forming lead, where it is releasing oxygen from itself and producing lead. So we have already discussed that releasing oxygen from any kind of compound to form another compound or element is called reduction, not oxidation. And here lead oxide is being reduced to form lead. So lead is not getting reduced. Lead oxide is getting reduced, but lead is not getting reduced. So this is wrong. Second option says carbon dioxide is getting oxidized. Now see, carbon is reacting with oxygen to form carbon dioxide. We have already discussed that when a particular element reacts with oxygen to form a particular oxide of that element, it is called oxidation. So carbon dioxide is formed due to oxidation, not that the carbon dioxide is getting oxidized. Carbon is getting oxidized, not carbon dioxide is getting oxidized. So this option will also be wrong. The third option says carbon is getting oxidized. Absolutely, because we can see clearly that carbon reacts with oxygen to form carbon dioxide. So carbon itself is getting oxidized to form carbon dioxide. So the third option is correct. The fourth option says lead oxide is getting reduced. Lead oxide, PbO, is releasing oxygen to form the Pb or lead. So we also know that releasing oxygen from any kind of compound, also known as reduction. So lead oxide is also getting reduced. So this is also true. So option C and option D will be correct, but option A and option B will be wrong. So in the next MCQ question, we can see here a chemical reaction is written, that is Fe2O3 plus 2 aluminium forms aluminium oxide and ferrous. So what kind of reaction is this? This is an example of combination reaction, double displacement reaction, decomposition reaction or displacement reaction. So now we can see that from ferric oxide, ferrous is being displaced by aluminium to form aluminium oxide, and the ferrous is released as free metal ions. So in this case, only a single displacement reaction is happening, where aluminium, which is chemically more reactive, is displacing chemically less reactive ferrous to form aluminium oxide from ferric oxide, and it releases ferrous as free metal ions. So the correct answer will be displacement reaction. So the next question is, what is balanced chemical reaction? We have already discussed that what is balancing and what is the necessity of balancing a particular chemical reaction. So balanced chemical reaction means when the number of atoms of the reactants becomes equal to the number of atoms of the products. So this is this particular nature of the chemical reaction is called the balancing of a chemical reaction. We balance chemical reactions in order to equalize the total number of atoms present in the reactants and the total number of atoms present in the products. So this is the process of balancing chemical reaction. The next question is, what is the necessity of balancing chemical reactions? When we balance chemical reactions, we equalize the number of atoms of the reactants and number of atoms of the products. By equalizing the number of atoms, we are also equalizing the total mass of reactants and the total mass of the products. And by doing this, we are actually obeying the law of conservation of mass. So in order to obey the law of conservation of mass, and in order to equalize the total mass of reactants and the total mass of products, we have to balance the chemical reactions by equalizing the total number of atoms present in reactants and the total number of atoms present in the products. So now in this particular reaction, we have a statement of chemical reaction that says barium chloride reacts with aluminium sulfate to give aluminium chloride and a precipitate of barium sulfate. So we have to translate this particular statement of chemical reaction into chemical equation, and also then we have to balance the particular chemical reaction. We can write this as the chemical formula of barium chloride, which is BaCl2 plus Al2SO4 whole three, that is the chemical formula of aluminium sulfate, and they react to form aluminium chloride, AlCl3 plus the precipitate of barium sulfate. So now we have to balance this particular chemical reaction. Okay, so now we have also written the physical state of barium chloride, that is aqueous, aluminium sulfate, that is also aqueous, aluminium chloride, that is also aqueous, and the precipitate of barium sulfate, that is in solid form. So now we have to balance this particular equation. Now see, the number of barium is 1, here also 1, so nothing with the barium. In case of chloride, we are seeing that there are 2 chlorine here and there are 3 here. In case of aluminium, there are 2 aluminiums here and there is 1 aluminium. So if we put 2 here, the chlorine becomes 6, 2 through 3 is 6. So we have to put 3 here in order to equalize the number of chlorine atoms. So now chlorine becomes 6 here also, chlorine here also becomes 6. Now the barium becomes 3 atoms of barium. So we have to put 3 here to equalize the number of barium. Now barium equalizes with in case of reactants and also in case of products. Chlorine and barium become equalized. Aluminium and aluminium become equalized. Now we are seeing that the number of sulfate, SO4, is here 3. And also we are seeing that the number of sulfate molecules here in case of reactants is also 3. So the final balanced equation, chemical equation, becomes 3BaCl2 aqueous plus Al2SO4 whole 3 aqueous, that forms 2AlCl3 aqueous plus 3BaSO4 solid precipitate. So now we have got the translated and balanced, fully balanced chemical equation of the statement of this chemical reaction. Okay, so now we have to balance the particular chemical equation that we have, that is zinc plus silver nitrate, which are forming together zinc, nitrate and silver. How? We first have to write the chemical formulas to write the chemical equation properly. Zinc Zn plus silver nitrate AgNO3, from that zinc nitrate plus silver, again a precipitate of silver is forming. So in this case we can clearly see that zinc is replacing silver from silver nitrate to form zinc nitrate, and it releases the free the silver in the form of precipitation. So zinc is chemically more reactive and silver is chemically less reactive. So now we have to balance this particular equation. We can see that zinc is 1 here in the reactants, also zinc is here 1 atom of zinc and 1 atom of zinc. Ag or silver is here 1 atom, here also 1 atom of Ag is present. Here NO3, the molecule NO3 is present in 1 atom, but here it is present in 2. So we have to write 2AgNO3, then it becomes ZnNO3 whole 2, and the Ag becomes 2 atoms, so it will be 2Ag. Again the Zn does not change in number, so it will remain same. So now we can see 1 atom of zinc, 1 atom of zinc, 2 atoms of Ag or silver, here 2 atoms of silver also, 2 atoms of nitrate, and here also 2 atoms, 2 molecules of nitrate. So the reaction becomes fully balanced. The next question says, why decomposition reactions are called reverse of composition reactions? So as we have already discussed, that composition reaction means two or three molecules or atoms of different elements combined with each other to form a particular new element or product. So this is combination, but in case of decomposition reaction, we have seen that a particular compound becomes dissociated to form two or more several products like B plus C plus D. So here a particular compound is being dissociated to form two or more products. So this is decomposition. So as we can clearly see that the combination reaction is absolutely opposite of the decomposition reaction. For an example, we can say that during combination reaction, 2H plus O2, it forms 2H2O. 2H2 plus O2 equals to 2H2, where two molecules of hydrogen react with one molecule of oxygen to form two molecules of water. So here two different types of elements are reacting with each other to form a particular new type of product. This is combination reactions. But in case of decomposition, we can reverse this particular reaction to get back to the previous one, like 2H2O, water dissociates to form two hydrogen molecules and one oxygen molecule. This is the exact opposite of the combination reaction. So by example, we have seen that combination reaction is absolutely opposite to decomposition reaction and vice versa. We already have discussed that iron in presence of free atmospheric oxygen and atmospheric moisture, it forms the rust, that is Fe2O3 or ferric oxide, the brown colored rust, and this causes breaking down of the metal instruments very easily. So in order to prevent the rusting process on the metal instruments in our daily life households, we have to paint the metal instrument with any kind of paint or layer of any other metal like copper, zinc, magnesium, etc., which are much more less chemically reactive than copper, than ferrous or iron. Iron is much more chemically reactive than copper, zinc, magnesium, etc. So we can paint the iron made instruments with copper, zinc, magnesium layer, or we can paint with colors, oil color, to prevent the formation of rust or Fe2O3 by oxidation, in order to preserve the metal made instruments for longer periods or for years. That is the reason why we paint the metal instruments with color or a layer of copper, zinc, magnesium, etc. So oil and fat containing food materials are mainly preserved with nitrogen or any kind of chemically unreactive or chemically less reactive gases. So because in order to prevent the oxidation of the food particles having oil and fats, to prevent their degradation and being rotten, So in order to preserve the food materials having oil and fat molecules or fat particles, we have to preserve those food materials or particles with chemically less reactive gases like nitrogen, helium, etc. to prevent the oxidation in order to preserve the food particles for longer period of time. That is the reason why we flush or cover the preserve the food materials having oil and fats with nitrogen, helium, etc. chemically less reactive gases. So now we will know what is the corrosion and what is rancid. These two particular concepts. Now corrosion is what we have already discussed, that the formation of rusting due to oxidation on iron containing metals to form rust or Fe2O3. This causes breakage of those metals. This is the concept of corrosion that we have already discussed. But what is rancid? Rancid means when we expose oil and fat containing food materials or particles for longer period of time, they become oxidized by oxygen in air, and so they become sour in taste, or their original taste becomes degraded, so they become undigestible or also can be toxic for. So that is the concept of rancidness, or become rancid. So this is corrosion and this is rancid. Corrosion is the formation of rusting or any metal body that is exposed in environment or free environment for longer period of time without any protection on it, that can be the rust, that can form rust on the outer surface of itself. That is the concept of corrosion. And rancid means the oil or fat containing food particles become oxidized by free oxygen present in air, and they become sour in taste, or their original taste becomes hampered, and they become also can be toxic for our health. So this is called rancidness. So this is all.